هذا الكورس الحقيقة عنوانه Corporate Finance، موجه لطلبة الـ MBA في الشهادات المهنية. في الحقيقة احنا انتهينا مع الطلاب قبل التوقف من الـ Introduction ومن الـ Cost of Capital، ودلوقتي هنشرح ما يتبقى عندنا two main financial decisions: the investment decision and the financing decision. Investment decision, this is called capital budgeting, or it's the last phase of the feasibility study. And we talked about the feasibility study in general in the class before we stopped. The general framework for the investment decision: we estimate the cash flows, either cash, the operating annual cash flows, and the terminal cash flow, and the initial investment. And as you may see in this slide, the annual operating cash flow equal to the EBIT times the 1 minus the tax rate, all plus the depreciation. Then we estimate the cost of equity, which is the opportunity cost, using maybe the CAPM, capital asset pricing model, as we previously mentioned in cost of capital. Then we analyze the risk, which is uncertainty or fluctuations. Actually, we have two methods to take the risk into consideration: either to change the discount rate, because the discount rate is a required rate of return, so we measured the risk and we use a higher discount rate if we have a higher level of risk. The second, or the other one, probability distribution for the expected cash flows, and then take the expected value. Here we choose the capital structure, estimate the cost of capital based on the capital structure, and we have already finished the cost of capital. We use the weighted average cost of capital. We take the summation of the multiplication of each cost with each weight, and then we get the present value of $1 or 1 Egyptian pound, either at a specific time in the future or for annuity, as shown in the equation. Then, making the decision by one of the three criteria: the payback period, after how many years the project can cover its initial cost from its expected cash inflows; internal rate of return, what is the expected economic rate of return as a percentage; and the net present value, which is the difference between the present value of the cash inflows and the present value of the cash outflows. Actually, both of payback period and internal rate of return suffer from severe problems. However, they are widely used in practice, but scientifically the best technique is the net present value. So we have to make the decision based on the net present value. Here is an example. We have a firm considers a project with the following estimations: $850,000 fixed assets in addition to $30,000 installation cost, $120,000 net working capital each year, and the weighted average cost of capital 17%. The acceptable payback period for such this project is 5 years. The expected operating cash inflows over the project life: $200,000, $250,000, $300,000, $100,000, $150,000, and the net terminal value, salvage value plus recovered net working capital, $200,000. We ask the student to evaluate the feasibility of the project using the three techniques and justify your recommendation to accept or reject. Actually, the initial investment equals the fixed assets plus the installation cost plus the net working capital. So it's $1 million. The cash inflows in the fifth year operating cash flow plus terminal value, $350, and the payback period, 4 years plus, which is mean 4.428, no equation here, which is shorter than the acceptable one, 4 years, so it's accepted according to the payback period. The net present value equal to the present value of cash inflows minus initial investment. We have the years and then the cash flows, and remember the cash flows, we add the terminal cash flow to the fifth year, so it's 350, and then we have the present value interest factor for each year because they are unequal cash flows, and multiply the cash flow for each year by the present value interest factor and then add together to get the total present value of cash flows, which is $753,550 minus the initial cost, which is $1 million. So it's negative NPV. So this project is rejected according to the net present value, which is different from the recommendation by the payback period. We have to go with the net present value. Then internal rate of return. Actually, the internal rate of return is the discount rate at which the net present value equals zero. So you can go through three steps. The first step, calculate as a first trial, calculate the net present value at any discount rate you can choose. For example, 10%. What is the net present value? It's a negative. So negative, not zero. So the chosen discount rate 10% is not the IRR. So we have to make another trial. But use a discount rate. We need to go from negative to zero. We need to increase the net present value. To increase the net present value, we have to decrease the discount rate. So go down. Instead of 10%, for example, we'll use 5%. At 5%, and you can calculate it at home, you will find the net present value positive, $33,050 or Egyptian pound. Again, as far as net present value is not zero, the 5% is not the IRR, but we know now that the IRR of this project between 5% and 10%. So in the third step, we can apply this equation, take the smaller, which is 5%, plus the difference between the larger discount rate 10 minus smaller 5, and then multiply by at the equation on the numerator, the larger NPV divided by the summation of the two NPV, but absolute value. Absolute value, which is mean, you have to take the absolute value of the two numbers, okay? 33,050 and also 100,750. So you will find that the IRR is 8.08%. So now we have to compare, make comparison between the IRR 8.08% and the cost of capital, which is 17%. So This project is rejected according to the IRR. Why? Because its expected return does not cover the cost of capital. Here you will find that both of the net present value technique and the IRR give the same recommendation, reject the approach. Now you have some assignment, and let's take another example. How can you take risk into consideration? So we can calculate the risk adjusted NPV. Here is an example. Hoki Corporation is considering two mutually exclusive projects. Both require an initial cost of 10,000 and will operate for 5 years. The probability distributions of the cash flows for the years 1 through 5 are given below. The firm used 12% as a required rate of return plus 3% for the riskier project. Which project to choose? And you have the probability distribution of the cash flows for both projects. Here you have to go through the following steps. Step number one, calculate the expected value or the average of the cash flow, which is the summation of the multiplication of cash flow times probability. For project A, give 5,000, project B give 6,000. You may here ask yourself why it is the expected value or the average is the same as the estimated value for the cash flow in the regular case, because the probability distribution here is normal probability distribution, but it is not necessary to get the same results. Then second step, calculate the risk using standard deviation sigma or the variance sigma square. But remember here that we are talking about expected values, not actual values. So we have the following equation: summation of the multiplication of the probability times the deviation between each cash flow and the bar value, which is the expected value, to the power square. We got the variance, and here you will find that project B has larger variance or larger standard deviation comparing to A, so B is riskier. So third step, A, take the typical discount rate 12%. B will take higher discount rate, which is 12 plus 3%, 15%. Step 4, calculating the risk adjusted NPV using the annuity present value table. The net present value for A equal positive 8,205, whereas the net present value of B equal 10,112. Both are accepted, but because they are mutually exclusive, we have to accept only one, most likely because our money is limited and we cannot carry out both of the two projects. So we have to choose B, which has larger positive NPV. And you have assignment. Then, now let's talk about the capital structure decision or financing decision. We have a very important two questions. The first one, what is the effect of using debt on the firm value or shareholder wealth? The another decision, as another question, I'm sorry, is what are the determinants of debt ratio inside the capital structure of the firm? We have several theories try to answer those two questions, but the empirical research as the results are mixed, and no single theory give a clear answer for the two questions. The theory started in 1958 by Modigliani Mirra, a relevant theory. Under the assumption of the perfect market, they expect that debt has no effect on the firm value. But in 1963, Modigliani Mirra again relaxed the assumption of no effect for the corporate tax, and they said that there is a positive effect for the debt coming from the tax shield, corporate tax shield. Then we have the optimal capital structure theory, trade-off theory, which said that the optimal or target capital structure or debt level, when the positive effect of using debt, which is the tax shield, equal to the negative effects such as bankruptcy costs and debt agency costs. Among others, Cruz and Lenzenberger in 1973 talked about the optimal capital structure theory. Then we have the agency theory, the debt agency cost by Jensen, 76, and Myers, 77. We have also signaling theory, but let's first talk about the debt agency theory. It said that maybe because of the conflict of interests between the principal, here the creditor, and the agent, here the company, the borrowing company, so maybe there is some costs, some debt agency costs. Okay, signaling theory, Ross in 1977 said that the decision of using debt, as if the financial manager inside the company send signals to the market, to the potential creditors and financial analysis, and there is also an effect for debt, which is positive effect because the people in the market think that if the company issue more debt, that a signal that the company has good investment opportunities in the near future. The pecking order theory by Myers and Majlev in 1984 actually said no optimal capital structure, but the firm, instead the firms, you pick the sources of financing according to specific order, starting from internal equity, which is the retained earnings. If it is not enough, going to external debt. If it is not enough, going to the last resort, external equity. هنا في الحقيقة المثال اهو قدامنا, example, the effect of debt on both of ROE and EPS. An all equity firm has total assets $20,000 with stock price $50. The company thinking in going into debt with $8,000 with interest rate 8% shows the effect of debt on the on EPS under three scenarios for the expected EBIT as follows: $1,000, $2,000, and $3,000. There is no taxes and no change in total assets nor the stock prices. Now we have to make our analysis under the current capital structure all equity firm, and then under the proposed capital structure using debt, to get both of the EPS and the ROE and compare together to make the decision. Under the current capital structure all equity, the number of shares outstanding equal equity divided by share price equal 20,000 divided by 50. equal 400 shares. Now you can go start with EBIT and both the three scenarios, recession, expected expansion, EBIT minus interest, no interest of course, because no debt, equal net income, and net income divided by net income divided by the 400 shares give us earnings per share. And if we take the net income itself divided by the equity, which is the total assets also, 20,000, give us the percentage of the ROE. Now, under proposed capital structure, we have to reduce the equity. The equity equal 20,000 minus the potential debt 8,000 equal 12,000. The number of shares to be less equity, the new equity, which is 12,000 divided by the price of the share 50 equal 240 shares. We have also interests. We can get the interests as an amount by multiplication of debt times the interest rate, 8,000 times 8%, equals 640. Now, again, the table to calculate both EPS and ROE under the three scenarios. The EBIT minus interest is 640 equal net income. Now, net income divided by the number of shares, but take care the number of shares is 240 shares, and to get the ROE, I'm sorry, here is E, but it's ROE equals the net income divided by the equity, which is 12,000. Okay, now you can compare under the recession, which is better according to the EBS, 2.5, but under the debt, 1.5. According to the ROE, 5% under recession, all equity, 3% under debt. So you can say that if you expect a recession, it's better to go away from debt. Don't use debt. Why? It's better to use equity, because under recession, your EBIT is low, and you may cannot pay the interests and face financial risk, or even if you can pay the interests, what left over to the shareholders is very low net income. So your EPS and ROE is very low. If you go through the expected or expansion, go toward expansion, debt is better than using debt, using equity. I'm sorry, debt, using debt is better than using equity. You will find under expansion or booming that the ايه ده؟ وانا كل ده ما بسجلش؟ يا نهار ابيض، يا نهار ابيض، ايه ده يا كريم؟ ايه كريم ده كريم؟ ايه؟ اصله ما كنت بعدين ارجع ازاي؟ ايه بقى الخلل ده؟